The first and last part of my lectures will be about canonical and subcanonical topologies. So if you consider an essentially small category and an arbitrary topology J on this category, then, as we have already said many times, we have the Yoneda functor from A to the category of presheaves, okay? And we know the Yoneda functor is fully faithful. And then we have the sheafification functor from presheaves to the category of sheaves for this topology. And the traditional notation is L for this composite functor. And we already remarked that this functor is, you see, it is something where you send your category A, which maybe has very bad categorical properties, in a category, a topos, which has really perfect properties, the same constructive categorical properties as the category of sets. So it is, for instance, remindful of the situation where you are studying, polynomials with polynomial equations with coefficients in some field, for instance in Q. And of course, these polynomial equations may have roots or not roots, or some roots but not all roots. And mathematicians have discovered along the centuries that it is very useful in such a situation, even if you are interested in polynomials in coefficients in Q, to embed Q in a bigger field where all equations have solutions. So you embed Q into C, for instance, a field of complex numbers, which is much better behaved. In the 19th century, so there was this theorem that any polynomial equation in C is a product of polynomials of degree 1. People call that the fundamental theorem of algebra. Probably we wouldn't use that name today. But what it meant for people discovering this fact is the fact that it was really extremely useful to be able to embed a setup which is quite complicated into a bigger context which is much simpler behaved. And here, in this situation, it is the same. You have a category and you embed it in larger categories, usually a much larger categories. This is small or essentially small, whereas this is not at all small, it is huge. But at least here you have arbitrary colimits, limits, and you have exponentials, you have the subobject classifier, and so on. You may able to do this, and so this means that if you are not able to make some constructions here, at least using the functor L, you can move from here to there. You can make the constructions you are interested in at this level, and then you wonder whether the objects you have constructed here come from objects of A. Or, if they may or may not come from such objects, but at least the question is well posed. And, of course, when you want to be able to go in one direction and then to go back, the situation is much better when this composite functor is still fully faithful. Of course, it cannot be true for all topologies. For if you take the topology where any sieve is covering, you get here to the topos with only one object, so it cannot be fully faithful. So a topology for which this property is verified, for which this functor is fully faithful, is called a subcanonical topology. Okay, so this is a definition. And in fact, in the usual geometric context, the usual topologies you consider verify these properties. Even in algebraic geometry, so for instance, there is not only the Zariski topology, but the Etal topology, the flat topology, all these topologies are subcanonical. But here we have a definition which has a meaning in any context. And then comes a lemma, an easy lemma, which is the fact that a topology is, so you consider a topology, okay, and then you have the following equivalences. So first, J is subcanonical, and it is equivalent to the fact that for any object of the category A, the associated functor, the associated préchief is a sheaf, is a J sheaf. So these two properties are equivalent. And they are also equivalent to a third property, which is the fact that J, the topology J, is contained in a topology which is called the canonical topology. So it means that if you consider all the topologies which verify these properties, in fact, there is a bigger one, which is called the canonical topology, and which can be made completely explicit. So maybe it is exaggerated to call it a lemma. I will call that a proposition, after all. Okay, so what is the canonical topology C, GC? So how is it defined? So you consider an arbitrary object in the category, and you consider a sieve on A, and you want to decide whether this sieve is covering for this topology or not. And so here is the definition. Say C belong to this topology if and only if for any euro from some object to A, the colimit with on the elements of the pullback of the sieve of the B primes is equal to B. So in this proposition, there are several statements. So maybe the first statement is the fact that this is a topology. So first, So I remind you the three axioms characterizing, defining the notion of Grothendieck topology. There is the maximality axiom, then the stability axiom, and the transitivity axiom. So why is the maximality axiom verified? If you take the maximal sieve of A, it's pulled back by any morphism is the maximal sieve of B, which contains the identity of B, and of course the collimit on this maximal sieve is B itself. So the maximality axiom is completely trivial. Then there is a stability axiom. If a sieve is covering of A, it's pulled back by any morphism is also covering. But this is by the very definition, because you see that in the, you have put the definition in such a way that it is stable by pullback. Okay, so stability is in the definition. And then there is transitivity, and transitivity is just the fact that the collimit of a collimit is a collimit. So please check it, but all these three things are very easy. So by now we have to verify these equivalences. So first we have that two implies one. If all representables are all representable pre-sheaves are sheaves, then the functor is L is fully faithful. Why? It is just because of the Yoneda lemma. Okay, because if you take two objects, you say you consider two objects A and B, and you are interested in the morphism like this, but what is L? L is, excuse me, but here, by hypothesis, the images of the objects by Y are sheaves. So this means that you don't need to apply J upper star. This means that these objects, this is HOM of Y of A to Y of B. And so, according to the Yoneda lemma, it is HOM of A to B. So we know that 2 implies 1. Then, we have that 3 implies 2. So if J, what does it mean? If J is subcanonical, that any covering sieve verifies this, any covering sieve verifies these properties. Okay? So you take an object, let's say, you take an object A in your category, and if you want to verify that this is a sheaf. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that if you take an object B and a covering sieve of B, then you want HOM of B to A is equal to the limit over the elements of the covering sieve of the morphism of B prime to A. But this statement is exactly that. Okay, so we have that three implies two. And oh, okay, so maybe I write it here. So we HOM of B to A equal limit so the meaning of this formula for any A is exactly that by definition of colimits. So it is completely tautological. Okay? And lastly, what we need to prove is that one implies three. If J is subcanonical, then it is contained in GC, which means any covering for the topology J verifies these properties. So you consider an element A, and you consider J covering sieve C. And what you need to prove is that this covering verifies these properties. So you already know that J is a topology, so it is stable by pullback. So this means that here, you can reduce to the. You just need to prove the statement where B is equal to A. Okay, you need to prove that the colimit over. Okay, we need to prove that. So what does it mean? It means that if you take any object in the category, you want om of A to X equal to the limit over the element of the sieves of om A prime of X. But by hypothesis, L is fully faithful. So this can be written om of L of A, L of X is equal to om of to the limit of the of these. Okay? Just because you apply the hypothesis that L is fully faithful. And this statement is certainly verified because you are in the topos. And in the topos, this statement is always true. Okay, so you see that this proposition is, in some sense, it is tautological. Okay? So, what I have said here is very simple, but in fact, even though it is very simple, it is quite fascinating because what it means that any category has a canonical topology. And you see, we didn't consider a particular category or categories verifying some properties. Any category you look at has a canonical topology, which is, in fact, usually highly non-trivial. Maybe I will say some words about it in a few minutes, but even if you consider, for instance, the category of differential variety, differential manifolds, or analytic manifolds, or schemes, I am not sure the canonical topology of these categories is well known. There are some well-known subcanonical topologies, but I'm not sure the canonical topology is fully explicited. In fact, preparing the talk, I have given some criteria for families of morphism in these categories to be coverings. But these criteria are not as explicit as I would want. And for instance, in the case of schemes, I will say a little later that so-called faithfully flat, quasi-compact families are coverings for the canonical topology. This was, in fact, used a lot by Grothendieck. But I have read in some paper that it is not exactly the canonical topology. But in the papers, in fact, the author does not give a counterexample. I would want to see a family which is a covering, in the case of schemes, for instance, a family which is a covering for the canonical topology and which is not generated by a fully faithful, quasi-compact family. I want to see an example of that. And so far, I didn't see. I think it is quite a subtle question. So, so this is a remark. But by now, I want to explain why the canonical topology is interesting from is very interesting from my point of view and should be studied seriously by geometers. okay, so before I move further, I want to make a remark about this definition. Here we have a definition of a covering sieve for the canonical topology. But if you remember in my previous talk this morning, I introduced the notion of J-covering family. Okay, in any topology, we have said okay, that if we have families of euros, okay, we say it is J-covering if and only if the sieve consisting of the FIs composed with arbitrary maps. Okay, so this sieve, if and only if this sieve belongs to the topology. Okay, here the canonical topology. And we can wonder whether we can make explicit when a family of morphism is a covering for the canonical topology. And it is possible, I will write it on the board. For this, I need a few definitions. So, first, there is a definition of epimorphic family. What does it mean for a family to be epimorphic? It means that for any B, the morphism from A to B embed in the product of this. Okay? So this is the definition of epimorphic family, epi. Then there is the definition of universally epimorphic. So if there are arbitrary finite limits in your category, you just have to say that this remains true when you take the pullback by any morphism from some object B to A. But in a general category, the fiber products do not necessarily exist. So we need to make a statement which makes sense in the general situation. So what does it mean to be universally epimorphic? It means that for any euro, let's say F from A to B, there exists a family of euros, let's say BJ to beam. So this, okay. And you want this arrows to be part of commutative squares like this. So here you have the Fij. Here this arrows you are called Fi. Okay, so you want that for, you see that for any such arrow in the family, okay, for any such arrow Gj in the family, it integrates in such a commutative square for at least one I. Okay, this is, of course, I don't say it has to be unique. I don't just want such a commutative square to exist. Okay? So you want such a family of squares such that the families of the BJs to B is itself a P. So this is the definition of universally epimorphic. So then there is a third definition, which is the third definition is the notion of strictly epimorphic. When is such a family strictly epimorphic? So the meaning of strictly epimorphic is not only the fact that this is embedded in that as a subobject for any B, but that the subobject inside this bigger set is defined by equations. Okay? So what does it mean? It means there exist families of some, let's say, CK. Together with commutative square like this. Okay, so such that for any B, the morphism from A to B is equal to the subset of the product over all the i's of the morphism of the AIs to B, which have the same image in the product over all the k's of the morphism of the AIs, of the CK to B. Here you have two arrows because you see for any k, what is the, for any choice of k, you have an induced map from this product to that. So it is induced by the two arrows, om of aik by this arrow, by composition. You see with the two arrows, ck to aik. And CK to AJK, which induce a map from the morphism from AIK to B to the morphism from ACK to B by composition. And here you have from the set of morphism of AJK to B to the set of morphism of MCK to B. So in the case if A has finite limits, it just means, what does it mean? It means that A is the co-limit of the diagram consisting of the sum, no, of the diagram consisting of the all the AIs and the CKs, okay, you have the families of the CKs, the families of the AIs related by the euros, excuse me, here it is the families of the AI fiber product over, okay, so you consider these two families and the euros are the projections. So when your category has finite limits, it just means that, you see, A is the co-limit, so it means you have to glue the AIs according to their fiber products. So this is the meaning of strictly epimorphic. So you characterize the image of this here by a family of equations defined by projections from a family of objects to these members of the original family. Okay? This is the definition of strictly epimorphic. And at last, there is the definition of universally strictly epimorphic. Okay? So this means that it is strictly epimorphic and stable under base change. So it means that for any euro from B to A, so here you are considering this family of euros, for any such euro, there is a family of morphism like this, inside commutative squares, such that the families of the BJs to B is strictly epimorphic, which has been defined at the step 3. Okay, so you want you see, it's just a notion of strictly epimorphic stable under base change. But as you didn't suppose base change to exist in the category A, you have to think about it in the category, in the associated category of presheaves. Okay, and this is the precise meaning of the statement. And so, corollary of the previous proposition is that a family of euros for the canonical topology is a covering, a family of euros is a covering for the canonical topology if and only if it is universally, strictly epimorphic. Okay. So, by now, I will explain why I have explicited this. This is the following theorem. So, suppose we have, once again, such a category A with the associated canonical functor. And you suppose this is subcanonical. And then you wonder about very classical problems in any geometric context. So the first problem you may get interested in is the following. Suppose you have a functor, a contravariant functor, to the category of sets, and you wonder whether this functor is representable. Then you have a necessary condition. If F is representable, you know it is a sheaf for the canonical topology, and a fortiori, it is a sheaf for any subcanonical topology. So here it is a necessary condition. But what does it mean? It means that if you have a functor and you wonder whether it is representable, if you discover this functor is not a sheaf for the canonical topology or for any subcanonical topology, it cannot be representable. So concretely, it has the following consequence. So practical consequence. If you take F, okay, and you wonder whether it is representable, the first thing you have to do, if it is not a sheaf for the topology J, is to sheafify it. And then you may wonder whether the sheafification is representable. In fact, there are very natural situations where you really do that. For instance, in algebraic geometry, some objects you classify are invertible bundles or on varieties. So, example, you have, let's say, a smooth projective variety. Okay, and you consider the functor which to any scheme X associates the same of isomorphism classes of rank one vector bundles on X cross S. So this is certainly a contravariant functor. But you check quite easily that this functor is not a sheaf, for instance, even for the Zariski topology. So what you do is, what people do is just to sheafify it. You sheafify for the Ethal topology. And then, a very important theorem of algebraic geometry is that it becomes representable. The scheme which represents this sheafified functor is called the Picard variety. It is one of the most important objects in algebraic geometry. Okay, so this was the first part of the theorem. By now, you may wonder about more specific functors. Okay, so this is part two of the theorem. So you consider a quiver D and a D diagram. So this means a representation of the quiver D in your category A. Your quiver may be finite or infinite, what you want. And of course, you will wonder about both limits and co-limits. So the easiest part is limits, as usual. So what can you do? So you have this functor which to any d associates an object, and to any euro in the diagram associates a morphism in the category. Okay. So what you can do is to compose this diagram with the canonical functor L. Okay, so then here you add this, you denote A dot, and you compose it with L so that you get by now a diagram in the category of sheaves. And in the category of sheaves, you can consider the limit. I remind you that in topologies, limits are always defined. And by now, you have the statement that this is representable by some object A. So this means, what does it mean representable? It means it has to be equal to some L of A, which is uniquely defined up to unique isomorphism because L is fully faithful. So it is representable by some A, if and only if A is a limit of D, is the limit of the diagram. So here you have an equivalence. This is, in fact, by the very definition of limits. Because if it is true in the category of sheaves, it is also true in the category of pre-sheaves, and limits are defined by going to pre-sheaves. So here, you really have an equivalence. So to say that the limit exists in the category A is equivalent to say that the limit in the topos is representable. It is an equivalence. So by now, we may, before we move to co-limits, which is a much more subtle question, I want to talk about exponentials. So consider two objects in the category. Then you can associate to them the sheaves they represent. And because these are objects of a topos, you can certainly associate to that an exponential. And then you wonder whether this object, which is well defined in the topos, is representable. And so the statement is that this is representable as L of some object, which you denote in this way, if and only if this is an exponential in A. Oh, yes, here, of course, in order for this to be true, you need an hypothesis. You need A to be so-called squareable in A. So this is an hypothesis. I forgot to write it. So the hypothesis is that for any object X of the category, the product of X with A is well defined in the category A. Okay, so this means, because of this hypothesis, the functor which to any X associates the morphism from X cross A to B, this functor is well defined from A opposite to sets. And so what I am saying is that this functor is representable in the category A if and only if this sheaf is representable, is the image of some object of F of A by L. So you see what it means. It means that this is exactly the same situation as when you are trying to solve polynomial equations by embedding in complex numbers. You have a polynomial equation with coefficients in Q. You solve it in C, and then you wonder whether the solutions belong to Q or not. Okay, so here you have an exponential, which is well defined anyway in the perfect world, which is the ambient topos. Okay, and you wonder whether the object, which is anyway constructible as a sheaf, does come from the category. But you see, in this situation, there are no two notions of exponentials. If the exponential exists, they are the same in the two categories, in the small category and in the ideal, perfect, big category you are embedded into. Okay, so this, in fact, please check it, it is not difficult at all. Okay, and by now you have the last part of the theorem, which will be the end of my lectures, and which is, I think, the most interesting part. So let's come back to a diagram in the category A and composite with L. So you have a diagram in the category in the topos. And then you can form the colimit of this diagram. It does exist. Okay, so you have a sheaf. And by now you wonder whether this is representable. Your sheaf is well defined anyway. Once again, you start with a category which maybe is very bad. And you have problems, especially with quotients. But you embed your bad category in a perfect category, a topos. You do the construction in the topos. And then you wonder whether the sheaf you are constructed is representable, whether it does come from the initial category. What does it mean, this condition? I write it again. And I want to state what it means. In fact, it is equivalent to three conditions. The first condition is that A is a colimit of your diagram in the category A. But what I say immediately is that this condition is much stronger than this one. In fact, this condition to be the colimit is the most basic notion of quotient. But in geometric context, most often it is not enough. If you look at books in algebraic geometry or in differential geometry and so on, Usually people are not satisfied with this condition. For instance, a very important question, when you construct a question, when you are, suppose you have a diagram, for instance, just a group acting on the space. And suppose you have a question of this space by the action of this group. You have the question, and by now you wonder about the points of the question. Okay, so suppose you are in this situation, you wonder about the morphism from some object B to A. So you see, if you have constructed a space as a quotient of something, it is certainly interesting to know what are the points of this space with coefficients in anything, especially with coefficients. So if you are, for instance, with a differential variety, here you put a point and you want to know what are the points. This is the first question. Or in algebraic geometry, here you would put the spectrum of a field and you want to know what it is. So if you simply have this condition, this question is extremely hard. In fact, because this is defined as a collimit. And the collimit is not at all defined in terms of this, of the representable functors associated to this thing. Excuse me. But what I say, a remark I already do by now, is that if you have this condition, then you know what are the points. You just take the collimit of these presheaves in a naive sense, then you sheafify, and it gives you the associated presheaves. Okay, this what does this statement mean? It means that the representable functor associated to the quotient is the sheafification of the collimit computed in the category of presheaves. So this means that at least theoretically, you have a way to compute all points. So this is really a very good notion of quotient, much better than this one. And here my point is that this notion is stronger than this one, and I want to make explicit what it means. So the second condition here is that if you consider the families of the eddies to A, you see A is a quotient of the eddies. So you have canonical maps from eddies to A. And this family has to be a J covering. In particular, as J is subcanonical, it has to be universally, strictly epimorphic. But it is not enough. Why is it not enough? It is because here you have a quotient in the topos. And a quotient in a topos, let's recall what we have said yesterday. We said yesterday that, that in a topos, to consider a quotient of an object is the same thing as to consider an equivalence relation. So here, this means you have to consider the relations generated by the euros of the diagram. The euros of the diagram define relations, and you have to consider the equivalence relation generated by these euros. And this equivalence relation has to define this quotient. So what does it mean? It means the following. Suppose you have two elements of your epimorphic family together with the two projections on A. And then, suppose you have an arbitrary object here. You see, this should be understood as a relation between two projections. Here, when you write these commutative squares, so this means you are interested the relations between the different objects which cover A. So suppose you have such a B. Then there so should exist a universally universally epimorphic family, universally strictly epimorphic family of morphism from B prime to B. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, the first example you gave, this this limit. So I understand that this is something related to this filtration, Hardin-Nurseyman filtration for curves, because you get these arrows, and if you have a curve over this vector bundle, maybe hollow vector bundles, and
excuse me, I don't I hear you very badly. I don't understand what you say.
You said that the first thing, the quotient construction, this A is limit of...
Yeah, A should be the collimit of the...
Collimit
A
of this, yeah. So this is something related to this Hardin-Nurseyman filtration of this curve?
No.
Because...
So anyway, here I am considering any subcanonical topology. But let me state the whole thing, and after that, I want to state first the theorem.
Okay.
Okay. The full theorem. So here, excuse me, I have said something which is not exactly true because I am considering an arbitrary subcanonical. Okay. So I want a J covering family of B by some B primes, and of course, J covering implies universally. Strictly epi. But if G is not the canonical topology, this is a stronger notion. If it is the canonical topology, these are equivalences. Okay, so I want a J covering family such that the induced arrows of B prime to ED and AD prime, you see here you have this diagram, this square, which is commutative. So this should factorize in the, so this, you should complete the diagram like this. Oh, excuse me. Here I denote it A D naught, A D one, A D n equal. So what do I mean by this? So this should be this part, should be the image by A dot of some sub-diagram of D, which has the following form. So it is a diagram of length n. You have D equal D naught, then D1, and so on. Up to the end. So here the objects are objects of D. And what I have written as D minus 1 double arrow DI, this should be equal either to an arrow from D minus 1 to DI in D or an arrow in the reverse direction. You see, I have to allow both directions because I want to generate the equivalence relation. In the definition of the equivalence relation, there is a fact it has to be symmetric. So if it has to be symmetric, I have to allow to reverse the order of the arrows. And I have, in the definition of the equivalence relation, I want it to be transitive. And this is because I allow diagrams of arbitrary lengths. What I am here writing in a rigorous way is just the definition, the construction of the equivalence relation generated by the arrows of the diagram D. And so you see the notion, the last condition, is that for any squares like this, you want it to be covered by a J-covering family of B primes to B, such that any B prime factorizes in this way. So you see, B prime is a relation between AD and AD prime. And what I want is this relation to be generated by the arrows of the diagram D. Okay? And so this is the statement of the theorem, that this thing is equivalent to these three conditions. And so, of course, the less stringent case is when J is a canonical topology. So then, it is written that this has to be universally strictly epimorphic. And this also, this, the families here, have to be universally strictly epimorphic. In fact, when the second condition is given, in the condition one, you only need this family to be universally epimorphic. The strictly will be implied by the part two. But so you see, here I have done something quite technical, but which is really dictated to us by Toposis. And here, I want to stress the fact that, in my opinion, this is a good notion of quotient in geometry. A good notion of quotient in geometry is a notion of quotient which is stable under embedding, at least in one topos. So if you consider all possible embeddings in all possible toposes, there is a smallest topos, which is a canonical topos. So you need at least your quotient to be expressed in this canonical topos. In particular, because it allows you to compute the points of the quotient from the points of the objects you are quotienting out. And so, you may wonder, okay, but in a concrete mathematical situation, suppose your diagram has a collimit in the category A, but the collimit does not respect this condition or that condition. Then it will mean that the representable functor, the representable sheaf associated to A, is not the collimit in the canonical topos. And in that case, my embedding is that the collimit in the canonical topos would be a better object than the representable functor. Because at least, so, okay. But so you see, here, I have done, you see that in everything I have said, I didn't make any choice. Because I said, after all, there is a, you see, we had this requirement, the topology to be subcanonical, because we wanted to keep track of the arrows. So then we discovered there is a canonical topology, which means there is the smallest completion of the initial category. Okay? And then we just write down what it means for this relation to be true in the topos. And we didn't make any choice, we just make explicit what it means. And we discover of a notion of quotient, which I think is a good notion of quotient in any categorical setting. You see, here we are in any category. And I think it is an illustration of the fact of the power of toposis, not only to prove things, but also to suggest definitions, even to dictate definitions to you. Okay, and then, okay, so by now, you see, I just write, the, in fact, I had never seen that in any book, because people didn't study topos enough. whereas, so, in my opinion, what should be done is just to look at, the, for instance, at the classical quotients constructed in geometry. There are many objects in geometry constructed as quotients, and for all these objects, you may wonder whether the quotients verify these conditions or not. For example, many moduli spaces in geometry are constructed quotient in this way. And you may wonder whether these conditions are verified or not. And everything here, everything has to be done. So these conditions may be verified or not by the classical quotients of algebraic geometry or analytic geometry or I don't know what. But at least here, you see, you have a definition dictated to you of what could be a good quotient. Okay, so this is...
Do you believe they are verified?
Excuse me?
Do you believe they are verified?
They are verified. No, it depends. It depends on the...
Okay, the question is, do you believe that these conditions are verified by the quotients that people
no,
already
so
invented.
Certainly. So, for instance, if you consider, so for instance, Grassmann varieties. So, you consider the quotient of a group by a parabolic subgroup. So, this certainly, it is completely clear it verifies this condition. Okay? By now, think about, for instance, the moduli scheme classifying. For instance, polarized abelian varieties. So it is constructed as, it is, in fact, it is constructed as a quotient. Yeah.
Mumford-Geisiger stability
yeah,
structure.
So
yeah,
so Mumford has a theory yeah,
exactly
of quotient,
this,
which is stability
is exactly
and semi-stability and
yeah,
so on.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is actually Hardener-Schumann filtration.
Yes,
yeah, yeah,
yes.
That is what I was saying then. When say,
okay, so this is, so the Mumford process, which
yeah.
is, in fact, what Mumford did, is just to look at what Hilbert had done 100 years ago,
yes,
and
yes.
to put it in a much more general and theoretic context.
Slope stability means he only restricted himself on this
yeah,
special...
So you should,
yeah.
I think, you should look at Mumford's theory
yeah, yeah,
of quotients, so the Mumford so-called stability and semi-stability
yeah,
theory,
yeah, yeah.
from this point of view.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
I
yeah.
am quite sure mm-hmm. that the stable quotient,
mm-hmm.
In the sense of Mumford, verify these conditions.
Yes.
So they are quotients verifying these
yeah,
conditions.
That intuitively clear, but my question is something different. Means actually Maxim told me you this Bridgeland stability, they also satisfy this kind of structure, but this is not a slope stability, but there is a filtration, but that is with respect
okay.
to some argument. So
yeah.
that construction is also the similar, but I don't know, means for hard dimensional varieties, it works or no?
Okay, so you see that Gourab has talking with Koncevich. So Koncevich has suggested to you, told you about something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And, but here I didn't know about what Koncevich had said, but we discovered it. We discovered this condition just writing down in an automatic way what topos dictate us. You see? So this means that when you think in topos theoretic terms, when you just apply what topos tell you to do, what you get is extremely natural. Yeah. Okay. So.